Alhamdulillah. So with that, we'd like to announce to and request all of you to come and join us, inshallah, as well for a graduation ceremony this Friday, November 13, after Isha, inshallah ta'ala. It's going to be a Quran night, so we're going to have, inshallah, recitation, bidnillah azza wa jal. And would like to request that you guys come and participate. There will be some activities and trivia, inshallah, to win some prizes. Come, bring your family, join, inshallah, the community, and enjoy, bidnillah azza wa jal, celebrating the new half of our community, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Make sure when you see the young child, or young, actually, half right now, inshallah, to congratulate him as well, bidnillah azza wa jal. You will see him well, you will recognize him when he comes, inshallah. He always comes actually here for the masjid with his family as well. Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira thumma amma ba'd. Does anyone know the end of anyone in this world, the Jama'ah, if it's going to be khair or bad, good or bad? Anyone knows? Do you have any guarantee from Allah Azza wa Jalla that you will have a good end? Do you have any guarantee about anyone that you hate that they're going to have a bad end? So there is no guarantee, right? So when it comes to obedience, when it comes to tawbah and repentance, how would you know that this person you now at this moment consider fasiq, fajr, kafir, disobedient, is going astray, and he's this and she's that and so on, how would you know that their end is not going to be better than yours? There's always hope, and we should always give people chance, inshallah ta'ala, opportunity to repent to Allah. Look at this example, which is like a very unique, a very, subhanAllah, kind of ironic example. People who don't think of these as examples for tawbah, but look what the Prophet ﷺ is bringing over here. In this hadith, Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, fi Riyad al-Salihin, in the book of Tawbah, Repentance, he says, قال وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يضحك الله سبحانه وتعالى يضحك الله سبحانه وتعالى إلى رجلين يقتل أحدهما الآخر يدخل الجنة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says in this hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exalted, smiles at two persons. When Allah smiles, that's in the Arabic language, yadhak, in a manner that suits His Majesty. This is the orthodox opinion of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that we accept the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way they are mentioned in the Quran, and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the Arabic language, as it was understood by those who received the revelation. Sorry for the interruption, Jama'ah. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he says يضحك الله, again, as human beings, we understand the Arabic language, we understand the meaning of the word يضحك, or smile, right, in English. But how does it look like? When it comes to Allah Azza wa Jal, we stop there. We know the meaning of the word, and it was mentioned to us in the Arabic language, a very basic, well-understood Arabic language, but the likeness of these attributes, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says about Himself, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like unto Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing resembles Allah Azza wa Jalla of His creation. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His attributes are unique. They're divine. They're not like the attributes of human beings. Again, so we stop at that likeness. As for the meaning of it, as it mentioned in the language over here, يَضْحَكُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى رَجُلَيْنِ يَقْتُلُ أَحَدُهُمَ الْآخَرِ. He said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala smiled to two people who will kill each other, or at least one kill the other one, and they will both end up in al-Jannah. How could this happen? I mean, didn't the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, al-qatil wal-maqtul fi al-nar, that the assailant and the victim, they're both going to end up in Jahannam when the two Muslims fighting each other? So how could that happen? Here's an example the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is mentioning over here. قَالَ يُقَاتِلُ هَذَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَيُقْتَلُ. Says one of them was fighting for the sake of Allah. So whether he was fighting in a Muslim combat, for example, or justice, you know, just fair war and so on, it was basically he was now in a position to fight for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. He was killed on the battlefield, and we considered him as shaheed. He ends up in al-Jannah. What about now the assailant? the one who killed him. Now the standard is that subhanAllah, killing an innocent, killing basically that if he was a Muslim and he killed another Muslim in the battlefield in that fashion, that is a major sin. It's a great sin. But what could happen to that individual? We assume this individual might end up in Jahannam, right? The Prophet ﷺ said, ثُمَّ يَتُوبُ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْقَاتِلِ فَيُسْلِمْ فَيُسْتَشْهَدْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might accept a repentance from that individual. So this person might become Muslim. And he might actually end up the same thing, being martyr. And he will enter al-Jannah. So what this hadith teaches us is that there is no judgment on any individual until this person dies. And we assume the end result of their a'mal will be shown towards the end of their lives. You don't even know. We might not survive long enough to see how their life is going to end up. So never ever judge people. If you see someone, not Muslim for example. Some Muslims, they live in this society, this community. Allah musta'an, they have challenges different than yours. Their level of iman is not as strong as yours. So regardless how much you try and how much you think, you know, that you know about them and their situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who knows their real circumstances. So never ever look at someone who looks to you at least less practicing or less serious about the deen in a way that is offensive, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be displeased with you and Allah will dislike from you. Not you ever. Because when you start acting like self-righteous, that means you're assuming everybody else to become what? Less practicing, not even Muslim. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time he was asked, as a matter of fact, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani Allah azza wa jal, if he dislikes any of the qualities of human beings, is to act arrogantly. Al-kibr. So some of the Sahaba, they kind of felt that they might misunderstood the meaning of kibr. قالوا يا رسول الله إن أحدنا يحب أن يكون ثوبه حسنا ونعله حسنا. You know, we like to have nice shoes and nice clothes, يا رسول الله. I mean, like, does that count as being arrogant? قال لا. No. This is not arrogance. He says قال الكبر بطر الحق وغمط الناس. Arrogance is when you reject the truth while you know it's true. And the second thing, غمط الناس, when you put people down, when you always vilify and mock them and put them down. Why do people put others down? Because they think they're superior. They're better than they are. And that's the arrogance over here. So in this hadith, some people might consider themselves, you know, better than everybody else around them. But again, only Allah knows how they're going to end. I know people personally, and I attended their janazah. I prayed janazah for them, that they gave the shahada on their deathbed. They were in the hospital, and they were dying. And when they were given their shahada there, subhanAllah, I've been there. I've seen it. I mean, maybe a few weeks before that, you would never imagine that person to become Muslim. But subhanAllah, this individual actually, he came attended the khutbah, my khutbah for Jum'ah. Not in this majlis, when I used to live in El Paso. So after, I met him before Salatul Jum'ah, and eventually we shook hands and we spoke a little bit for a few words. And he sat down in the masjid attending. And I told him we'll meet afterwards, inshallah. So when I finished khutbah al Jum'ah, I realized that there were people gathering in one corner, and subhanAllah, everybody's kind of crowding over him. And I don't know what's going on. So someone comes to me, says, Sheikh, quickly. I said, what happened? I said, the guy is crying. He's crying so much. And I thought, someone must have said something bad. Someone must have offended him, or maybe didn't see him praying with us, whatever that situation was. So I go, and we pulled the guy, we took him to the office, and then kind of trying to manage the crisis right now, knowing what's going on. And the man was still crying, couldn't even talk. So when we finished, I said, so tell me what happened. Did anyone say anything? Were you offended by anything we said? Or anyone maybe said something bad to you? He goes, no. I said, so what is it? He goes, I have never been so peaceful in my life. He goes, I've never felt so peaceful in my life. In these just 45 minutes I attended Khutbat al-Jumu'ah and Salat al-Jumu'ah, he said, I've never been so peaceful in my life. I'm like, Allah musta'an. I almost had a heart attack. That someone had said something bad to him, Allah musta'an, that will kind of send this person far away from Allah Azza wa Jal. But alhamdulillah, we had a nice conversation afterwards. Alhamdulillah, Rabbi Ameen. And then he left. Then soon after that, maybe a week later or so, the brother who brought him to me, he calls me, he goes, Sheikh, I have some bad news. So what's going on? He goes, you know Brother Fulan, this guy that I brought with him? I said, yes. I said, he's in the hospital. So what's going on? He said, he has a very advanced stage of cancer. He was diagnosed with cancer right away, subhanAllah. And it was like a devastating moment. So quickly, subhanAllah, things escalated quickly. At some point, I went to see him in the hospital. Unfortunately, he was unable even to speak, but he was able to understand. So as we were talking to him, and he was very happy, I was reciting Quran, and he was kind of like excited. So we kind of tried to help him to give the shahada, and alhamdulillah, he gave the shahada to the best of his ability. And then soon after that, not few days afterwards, actually he passed away. SubhanAllah, we could negotiate with his family. His family accepted to give us the responsibility of him taking the burial and everything and so on. But then after we make arrangement and everything, alhamdulillah, his family kind of like backed out. And they insisted on taking his body. We tried everything. And we know that they might not have the cost to cover all the expenses of that. We said, we'll take care of everything. You don't worry about it. Just sign the papers, we'll release him to us, and we will just take care of him as a Muslim brother. We'll bury with us. Somehow they refused. But the last thing that they accepted, at least, and we made kind of deal with them, is at least if you give us the chance to come to the funeral home before you take him away, so we can just pray Salatul Janazah for him. So they took care of him, they washed him, and they put him in a suit and casket and everything and so on. And we just came towards the end of their event, the group of the community, and we prayed Salatul Janazah for him, and he was taken away. SubhanAllah. Wallahi, that was an amazing, amazing event. I couldn't even believe it myself. All happened within such a very short time. A few weeks before that, he was like anyone else in the street. That week, he became a brother to you. One of the Muslim, community, members of the Muslim community. So you cannot judge the people's end. It's in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi, you can't even judge your own end. And that's why with the ulama, we're talking about who could be the best role model for me and you. You know what they said? قَالُوا تَأَسَّوْا بِمَنْ مَاتْ فَإِنَّ الْحَيِّ لَا تُؤْمِنْ عَلَيْهِ الْفِتْنَةِ. If you're going to take role models, then took those who already died. Because the living, they're not yet safe from the fitna. No one is safe from the fitna. So don't look up to those who are still alive. You know, you see them on the minbar in big halls and lectures and so on. You know, learn from them. But don't attach your heart to them. If you want to attach your heart to those who were safe from the fitna. People such as the Anbiya and the Sahaba and the Ulama al-Salihin. The one who's been received the testimony of the Muslim world throughout the history. That these were righteous people. Those are the kind of people that you have to attach your heart to and try to follow their steps, inshallah, tabarakah wa ta'ala, because at least from what we have seen from the testimony of the people for them, they had the best end anyone can really wish to have in this dunya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us husn al-khatima, jama'ah. Make us among those who always repent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah azza wa ta'ala to give us the ability to produce a tawbah, a sincere tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A tawbah that will never regress and go back again to our bad habits and bad ways. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the ability to instantly keep coming back to Him over and over again. And then every time we come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa ta'ala forgive us. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our repentance. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never close the doors of mercy in front of our faces. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to always accept us, Ya Rabbil Alameen, under the shade of his arsh. يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظُلُّهُ. When there will be no shade but His subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu ta'ala. Any question, Jama? Yes?
So in regards to not judging people, where do you draw the line between somebody who's earned a particular reputation in the community and you obviously don't want to judge them.
Nah.
But of course, you can't be naive of the reputation in dealing with them.
Nah. So where would they draw the line between someone that or they already earned a reputation in the community because of their wrongdoing, for example, without being so naive about their actions? You see, on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not judge you, will not hold you accountable for not calling this person what they deserve. But He will ask you and hold you accountable for calling someone names that did not deserve. If he or she is fasiq, If he is your adulterer, for example, Allah will not hold you accountable if you don't call them adulterer or fornicator. But if you call someone so and they're not deserving of that title, you will be held accountable for it. So in terms of going out there and telling people this is a thief, this is this, this is that, this is that, you're not responsible for this. But at the same time, you, through your actions, be responsible and be cautious when you deal with people. And if someone asks you for a nasiha, then you give them the nasiha the way it should. Meaning you tell them what you know without exaggerating things. In addition to that, if you know that this person is involved in certain serious actions in the community that you believe might cause some damage or hurt somebody and so on, then as part of the nasiha for the Muslim, you tell the people to, you know, be careful. As long as you also give that brother or sister share in da'wah and guidance. Like you tell this individual, listen, you shouldn't be doing that. And if they insist, that's between them and Allah Azza wa Jal. Your job is to deliver the message. Guidance is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam. Now, any questions, Jama'ah? Khair, inshallah ta'ala. Please don't forget, inshallah ta'ala, this Friday, November 13th, inshallah Azza wa Jal, celebration is going to be after Isha for the graduation of Sayyid Abdul Baqi, the son of Brother Abdul Wadud. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.